Meeting of the Edgecombe County Board of Education, Board of County Commissioners, please come to order. I call the Edgecombe County Board of Education to order at this time, and beginning at my left, the staff and board members will identify themselves.
Evelyn Shaw Wilson, Vice Chair of the Edgecombe County Board of Education.
Board member.
Michael Meyer, Deputy Superintendent.
Charlene Tittman, Assistant Superintendent of Human Resources.
Karen Swanson, Assistant Superintendent for Innovation and Strategic Planning.
Chairman Wiggins, all county commissioners.
Thank you, Reverend. At this time, I'd like to call the county board of commissioners to order.
Good evening, Eric Edwards, District County Manager.
Ralph Williams, Service District Five.
Baldwin Harris, District Two.
Evelyn Powell, District One.
Joseph Thorne, District Four.
Evelyn Best, Deputy County Manager.
Michael Peters, County Manager.
Michael Matthews, Assistant County Manager. Okay, run this up.
Fran Longo, Procurator Board.
Russ Cole, Liaison to the Board.
At this time, as you notice, we have been so hesitant.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman, thank you all for considering these budget amendments. A couple of these are time sensitive. I'll briefly give you a summary of each one. You'll see budget amendment number one is in part of social services. This is to budget some additional revenue that will be appropriated in. Likewise, appropriated expenditures, budget amendment number two. This is for register of deeds. We are appropriating additional revenues there to match the actual revenues. We've got more revenue in that line than expected. Budget amendment number three is to move funds in the sheriff's office from salaries to salaries overtime to cover additional overtime costs in his office. Budget amendment number four is to reclassify for interest related to certain debt service that we have. No additional appropriation fund balance there. Budget amendment number five, this is to appropriate grant funds we're receiving, emergency services for our EMPG grant. Budget amendment number six, this is to make corrections in the revenue line. It was appropriated to incorrect revenue line, so that is to correct that. And finally, budget amendment number seven, we budgeted the payment for sheriff's office body cameras, but that should come out of capital outlay. We said budget amendment to move that to a line labeled body camera. So I recommend that you approve those budget amendments as presented.
Or give a motion and question. Here none. Is there a motion to approve?
Motion for acceptance.
Budget one through seven. Any questions? If not, all in favor, let it be known by the vote, aye.
Aye.
All opposed? If not, budget amendment is approved. Forward with the question. Mr. Edwards.
Good evening, everyone. It's always wonderful for us to have this opportunity to meet and to share some things that are going on, certainly in the county. We're always eager to hear about great things going on with the Edgecombe school system. Normally, I do a presentation to look back over the year behind us, talk about some major things, major challenges. I want to take a little bit different approach to share some very important work that we have been doing here lately as it relates to county vision and strategic planning. So we have, over the last couple of years, internally been spending some time looking at our internal operations. As you do, I'm sure, other organizations, we're always looking at where we need to make improvements, how we can improve. We have, certainly, everyday county business. We're always working on doing a better job at serving our citizens. In particular, we've been looking at a few different areas, one being positive employee experience, wanting to make our employees feel better about working for the county, attract more people, retain more people. We've been looking at our leadership capacity. We've been spending a lot of time in leadership development in the organization. We've been looking at how we can be more efficient in our operations. You know, we always have to work that magic of doing more with less, so we've been looking at how we can be more efficient, and certainly been looking at how we can gain and maintain financial stability. So that's some work that's been going on within, inside of our shop for the last almost 3 years. And our mission to be the organization that our citizens need and deserve. So as we've been doing that work, we realize that it's almost like we've been working on our airplane, right, so that it will fly better. But we hadn't stopped to think about, okay, where are we flying to exactly, right? Are we going to do anything different than what we've been doing? Otherwise, we're just going to taxi around the runway, round and round. So we want to take a moment to really think about, where do we want to go as an organization? Where do we want to go as far as leading our county? So we spent considerable effort and time looking to the future for our county. We spent several sessions with our department heads, gathering their valuable feedback from them. Then at the board's last retreat, we spent a good part of that retreat gaining valuable feedback from our board. We asked ourselves the question, what's our vision for the county from our citizens' perspective? And then we asked, well, what's our vision for our organization? We have to look not just externally, but we have to look internally too. Who do we want to be as an organization? And then we have been talking about, and we're still in the budget process, how can our budget better reflect our vision? So from the feedback that we've gathered from our department heads, the feedback that we've gathered from our commissioners, we have fashioned together sort of a two-sided vision statement. And so you'll see that displayed here. And I know we've got educators in the room here, so I know you won't mind if I ask for us to at least read that first vision together, because I want to do that, because I want you to hear it and feel it, because this is not just us, this is you too. So you'll see that the vision said, our vision for the county is, Edgecombe County is a historic place that values its residents and natural resources and creates opportunities where people are proud to live, work, and play for generations to come. Right? That's our vision. Now, to get there, we won't read that, but you'll see that we've got to be a certain kind of organization to lead our county to that place. So you see, we've built in here a lot of value statements that came from both reflections from our board as well as from our staff. That, you know, we talk about who we want to be as employees. We want to be committed, provide exceptional services, be innovative, passionate, creative, devoted to excellence, integrity, and transparency for the growth of county and staff. So we've got this two-sided vision statement. Now, a vision is just a vision if you don't put action behind it, right? So you've got to put a driving force behind that in order to take the steps that you need to reach the vision. And so to get that motivation that we need to drive this vision engine, we look to the legacy of our former county manager, Mr. Carmon. Many of you have were fortunate to know him and to work with him. I was honored to serve under him for 14 years. And Mr. Carmon used to say this all the time, I'm sick and tired of being at the top and bottom of every bad list. And to that we all say, amen. I know I should have been working here at Edgecombe County for 21 years, going on 22. Been looking at the top and bottom of those bad lists for a long time. I don't know about y'all, but I'm sick and tired of it. I totally agree with him in that. And so really, he used to say that all the time, and he lit a fire inside of us who had the opportunity to work with him. And certainly he did a lot of things to point us in that direction. So we as staff, we stand on his shoulders in this work that we are trying to do now. So we have reduced that sentiment that he used to frequently say into one very short statement, and this is our call to action. Simply, get off the list, right? That's what our work is, to get off the list. Whatever that list is, it might be to get off it, to move down it, move from the top to the bottom, bottom to the top, whatever it is, but we're shortening it to say, that is our call to action, to get off the list.
And unfortunately, there are a lot of roots. There's a lot of work. You know, we've got high unemployment in the county. We often have the highest unemployment rate in the entire state. Last time I checked, we're like number six. I'll take that. That's not far enough from the top, so we still got to work on that. We have poor health indicators. We are a tier one county. Education attainment declining. We're one of the few counties in North Carolina, one of a handful of counties in North Carolina with a declining population as of the last census. And out of 100 counties, we are number 99 out of 100 counties on the county health rankings. And I provided you a copy of that in your packet. You'll see that. I won't go through that. But you can see, and it says at the top, 99 of 100. This is a yearly ranking that comes out. It is a nationwide ranking. They rank every county in every state. We are 99, right? You're going to see this again because we're going to use this list here as a focal point for the work that we're going to be doing, because not only do we not want to be 99 on this list, but you'll see it also has other information up there like unemployment rate, number of high school graduates, median household income, all of those things that accumulate to what they call the health ranking for a county. It's not just health, but it's the health of the economy and the citizenry and all of that. So this encapsulates a lot of the list that we want to focus on. So really, for us to get from where we are to this vision of where we're trying to go, we have to build a bridge, right? It does not happen by itself. We don't wake up one morning and all of a sudden say, wow, look how Edgecombe County has changed. That's amazing. No, it does not happen like that. So to get from here to there, we've got to build a bridge. And it's hard work. It is long-term work. It is work that will continue. We were talking about retirement sitting at the table. I got about 7 years to go. It will be work that will go on even after I have retired, right? So it is long-term work, but we won't make it together. We won't make it there if we don't do it together, right? So I want to share this with you tonight because you are a vital part of this work that we're going to be doing. And I am absolutely convinced that it can be done if we stay committed to it. And I invite you to join us in all of the work. There's going to be multiple meetings, lots of work, committees and things like that. Just roll up our sleeves to get some of this done. In fact, some of you have already received an invitation. If you haven't, this is your invitation. Part of the work is going to start tomorrow afternoon, in fact. So we're going to get together in this room. We've invited many of our partners and stakeholders from all across the county to join us to look at that list, or those lists, that collection of lists that you just saw. And what we want to do is to pick out three or four focus areas, because we can't do it all, right? So we need to focus. Pick out three or four focus areas. And then we're going to talk about what are some programs and some initiatives and efforts that are already working. Because the second thing I believe, not only can this happen, I believe that there are already the solutions out there to get us off of these lists, right? There's tremendous work going on out there. A lot of it is happening right inside of Edgecombe County Public School System. Also, in some of our nonprofit partners or what have you, there's a lot of great work out there. We need to make sure that we know about it. We need to help elevate it. We need to expand it, and we need to multiply it. I told you I got 7 years. So I don't have time to reinvent the wheel, right? So we will take what's working and support it and multiply it and expand it. So I invite you to join us tomorrow afternoon if you're available. If you can't, don't worry about it. There will be certainly other meetings that you'll be able to be a part of this so that we can do this good work of getting off those lists. So who's with us? All right, I see some hands. All right. You will be able to look back one day and say, look what I've got to do in Edgecombe, right? I believe we can do it.
Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Studying and being able to really kind of find their passions and dreams. that has been at Princeville, West, and North. It's transitioned from the classroom or into school, outside of school, into internships and externships. So students, when they find something they're really good at and they like, it's not just at school. We want to make sure that outside of school, they're able to participate in those same items. The next bullet that says coming in 2023-24, you see Hope, you see Virtual, you see Twilight. So Hope is our alternative school, is 6 through 12. And we know that those students sometimes struggle with behavior concerns. Virtual, or some students are not doing face-to-face learning. And so for next year, we're thinking about a virtual school in 4th through 12th grade. We just feel like K-3 is not a good place for virtual students. And then Twilight is a new program that we want to put together. And that new program is modeled after a program that was in Gilbert County. But those students come to school in the evening. They would come, say, Monday through Thursday or Monday through Friday from 3 to 7 p.m. Those students would be ages 17 to 21. So we're trying to help them graduate, help make sure that they have some opportunities. It's not based on behavior, it's based on your credits. You need to be able to graduate. We want to make sure that you're employable and get you on your way. And so we're thinking about for the 23-24 school year, putting those schools together, not physically, because virtually you're not here, you're not in school, but Hope is at Charter High and Twilight will be in the evening program. And so that's what we're thinking about. When we look at some of our numbers, when we look at some of our students and some of the struggles they might have, it may be a student who has a child, it may be a student who really does need to work full time, this still gives you an option that you can still graduate, you can still get your degree. Okay. And then when we think about talent recruitment and development, this is priority two. And so just wanted to give you a little overview of some of the opportunity culture levels that we have. And we have something called MCL, so that's multi-classroom leader. And I just want to highlight, so that multi-classroom leader both teaches and supports other staff members. And so that's their major role. The expanded impact teacher, or EIT, this person has excellent instructional skills. And so this person has more students than the average teacher. And you see 33 to 65% more students. So that's their role. And then the REACH associate is a paraprofessional, so we typically call them teacher assistants. And they're excellent at their work. And so they're in a position where they are supporting additional teachers or additional teacher assistants. And so these roles are through our district. And at any of our schools, we have 21 MCLs, we have 9 EITs, and we have 7 REACH associates. And really, the process that we use is we're interviewing folks that are part of our district. We may have a few that come outside of our district, but most of these are homegrown, they're part of our school system. We've interviewed you, you have a proven track record of success, and based on where you kind of fit on this role, that's where we are. We're pushing you in and supporting you in those lessons. These have been a game changer for us. They have helped with supporting the classroom. They have helped with developing other teacher skills, and they have helped with some of our academics with our students, making sure that they're successful. These are two samples of two schools, and I just picked South and Stocks, and it shows you what their opportunity culture staffing patterns look like. At Stocks a few years ago, we did dual practice, so it kind of just tweaked. Principals look and they determine where do I reach the support based on my data. And so they will, you know, decide I need a science MCL, I need a science teacher that's going to be able to go in and support other science teachers and pull those test scores up. So each school has a different pattern and plan. This really doesn't take additional money. It's based on the staff that they have. It might be Title I funding, or maybe I decide I'll have one less teacher. Then I'm going to fund some of these other positions. And again, each of these roles, they make a little extra. It's not a whole lot, but they do a whole lot of extra work. And so again, one of the ways that we have found to be successful and make sure that our teachers with a proven track record who've been successful, they're good at building relationships, they're great at academics, building climate and culture in the classroom, and behavior management. Those are the folks that are doing this extra work. And then here are some of the impacts. And again, some of these impacts they're listed, but there are lots of impacts that really can't be quantified. It's hard to be able to show everything that happens, but we see teacher support has increased, Teacher turnover is decreased, principal capacity to lead is increased, and student-teacher ratio is decreased because we've got extra hands in the classroom and it's helping our students to be successful. So all the areas we want going up, we see it going up. The areas that we want to see decreased are going down. And then equity in action. And so when you think about the code of conduct, you think about restorative practices, we have to be mindful that we hold the whole child. We want to make sure that we're helping our students be successful. And so when we think about that revised code of conduct, sometimes we look at our policies, we look at our procedures, and sometimes they're barriers for our students. And so we look at our data and we figure out what we need to change in our policies, what we need to change in our procedures so that we can help students to be successful. And so that's some of the work that we're working on. We're also looking at an equity audit. And with that equity audit, we really want to be mindful of what are the things that we might be unaware of that are impacting students negatively and how do we tweak that. You see the pre-K for three-year-olds, we know that as early as we can get students in, that's the best time to do it, right? So there's no catch-up, there's no gap in learning, there's no lag in learning. And so we've implemented pre-K for three-year-olds and we're continuing to build that program. And then our purposeful partnerships. We believe that when we have partners, we should get partners who align to our vision and dreams and not just go out and say, oh, you're willing to help. We want folks that align to our work. And so some of the things that we've been really successful with has been our scholar teachers. You see the numbers there, 13 current staff members who have gone through the scholar teacher program at Edgecombe Early College. And then we have 16 that are future staff members, meaning they are currently in college or they're at Edgecombe Early College going through the scholar teacher program. North, we talked about that earlier, so those are the internships and externships through North. You see the companies, again, purposeful partnerships, partnerships in our community who are willing to have our students come in to work. Again, they get to see, what do I like about work? What do I want to change? How do I decide what I want to do when I go to college? Or if I decide I want to stay in the workforce, I've got a leg up on students who maybe have not had these experiences. And then, coming 2023-24 is us rebranding our family resource center. So we've had a family resource center for a couple of years and we've done some great work, but we really want to take that to the next level. We want to do some work supporting families and supporting students a little bit more deeply than we have before. And so as we open up the 2023-24 school year, we have a new person who's coming into that role and we want to rebrand them. And then I want to put your attention to our scholar teacher cohort. And so this is exciting. You see to the right three of our current employees for ECPS. They are scholar teachers. So they graduated. And so them graduating, coming back, that was under, right? We started the program. We sent them off to school. The idea is they go to school. They have 3 years to get their teaching certification. They sign a promissory note. They come back. Our first week have come back. And so we're really excited about that. But what's as exciting is look at the list, right? Look at the list. We have 19 more who are in the hopper to come back. And so we're helping to solve our issue with teacher shortage, right? We're creating our own. We're making sure that our students go out and they come back. And if we see some on this list and the number changes and I decide I don't want to be a teacher, we want you to find that out before you go into a classroom. Right? If you say, that's not really what I want to do, I want to do something else, we're okay with that. Just remember, each of these students represent $30,000, which is $10,000 each year. And after they finish at their early college, they only need 3 more years in college in order to be able to complete their degree. That's a promise that they make, and if they change their mind, if they can sign that promissory note, so money comes back to us. But we feel like this is a win-win, and we're super excited about that. Okay, and then resilient foundation, and so that's priority 5. And so as you'll hear from Mr. Williams, and you'll hear from Mr. Perkins this evening, we know that we have facilities. This is not new. They've plagued our school. We have very old facilities, but we also have a really phenomenal maintenance department. And so we try to keep that balance. We have been fortunate in never think COVID is a great thing, but what I'll say is with the ESSER funding, we were able to do some things in our schools and our buildings that we wouldn't have been able to do in the past years. That really helped us, and again, as they go through their presentation this evening, you'll see a lot of the work and the pictures, and they shared that, and that gives you an idea of all the work that has been done, and then we have some other work that will be done. And you know as well as we do, there's backlog, but again, we've placed the money there, we have things ordered, and we're excited about that working out. I want to bring your attention to this. It's been a little while since we looked at this chart. I think I had it up for you after the 18-19 school year, and so you had seen those last two columns. And so just for us to remember, the 16-17 school year, you see where I am. And so we had six schools that met or exceeded growth. Three exceeded, three met, and then we had eight schools that did not meet growth. I became superintendent in July of 2017, and that just was our reality, right? So we had to work through that. What does that look like? How did it not make it different? That wasn't good news for us. We didn't like seeing it that way. So some of the things that we have been doing and we continue to do. So you think about opportunity culture, you think about Spanish immersion, think about the micro school that we started. So lots of the things that we've done that are innovative, that we've said, we want to ask students what matters to you, what's important, and how do we make sure that we get quality teachers in front of you. That's where we saw the difference between 16-17 and 17-18. So when you look at that, we went from 6 to 11. Right? 4 exceeded, 7 met, 3 did not. Still not good enough. So in 18-19, we continue to work, we continue to figure out what works, how we want teachers, how do we make sure you have the resources that you need to get better. And we went from 11 to 12, 6 met, 6 exceeded, and 2 did not meet. And then for the 19-20 school year, we were really upset. That was COVID year. Our principals were upset because they said we were going to be 14, right? And that was the plan, and we do believe that, right? But we didn't get an opportunity to test. We know what happened during COVID. We've seen data from the state about the learning loss and all those things that don't make you feel good. So that sat there. Then 9/21/22, and you see our data. 9 schools, 2 exceeded, 7 met, 5 did not. It is not what we want, but if you look back and we're honest, in 16-17, we're better than we were, right? So I believe that when we look at the 17-18, 18-19 year, we have figured out what to do to make it work. Now we can't help the closure, right? But as soon as we get back up, when we get running, we're moving in the right direction. We are not, again, where we want to. I want us to make sure that when we come before you, that we have 14 at the top and we have 0 at the bottom. That's the goal. And not just 14 to meet, we want 14 to exceed. We want our students to be progressing and moving in the right direction. Right? And so, again, I put this in front of you to say we're working on the things that need to be done. I think we have a good idea of how to help students hopefully be successful. I think as we're adding in new programs, we'll open up our Edge Academy in fall of 2023. Dr. Mara can share a little bit about that. We are trying to make sure we provide opportunities for the students to be successful. It doesn't happen overnight. It happens with hard work, great decision, and that's what we're doing. So I will stop there, and I have Dr. Mara in Wisconsin. So come forward, we'll share.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. It is great to be here with you, and Dr. Myrick and I have the pleasure of sharing a few of the exciting things happening in the district that are driving towards that vision that Dr. Bridges just shared with you. So our priority that we're going to talk a little bit about tonight is academic excellence, and of course we're focused on high-quality teaching and learning, and reimagining learning experiences so that every child gets an excellent education here at Edgecombe County. We'll cut off the bottom, but I think you can read this. So our priorities for 22-23 year. First, designing a vision for learning, which I'm going to share with you a draft of in just a second here. Engaging our teams at Tarboro High School and Southwest Edgecombe High School is some redesign work. Y'all will remember we spoke several years ago about the redesign work we did in doing at North and at Phillips, and so we're really thrilled that we had a chance to engage Tarboro and Southwest in that work this year. Dr. Meyer again is going to talk about the Edgecademy of Health Sciences that will open this fall. And then finally, of course, we're supporting the implementation of innovative learning experiences across the entire district. So we'll share some of those with you all. Some of those are coming right here back up. Very quickly, I wanted to share with you this vision for learning. So what we've been up to this year is, and I think Mr. Evans, you put this very well, we're trying to put our vision into action. So several years ago, we worked with members of the community, many of you in this room, to develop our graduate aims, which you'll see across the top of the screen here. So purpose, agency, civic and social engagement, community-driven and resilience. These are the things that we said we want all of our graduates to be able to live into by the time they're 25 years old. So this is not new. Those aims have been there. What we wanted to get clear on this year is how we're going to make those experiences or that vision come alive, rather, in every single school in Edgecombe County Public Schools. And you know, our work over the past several years has been about piloting new things, trying out new ideas in various places, and now we're at the point where we're saying, gosh, like, we want to be sure that every single kid, no matter what school they go to in Edgecombe County, is having these four experiences in their schools. We also felt it was really critical to put a stake in the ground around this as we're thinking about bringing in four additional schools or around 1,800 additional students from the Rocky Mount area. And so those students too will have the experiences that you see up on some of the wall today. So we're excited. You'll see it in like little light letters at the back. It still says draft because this is still in draft form. We're still getting feedback on this from students and families, community members. Our schools are right now in the process of doing focus groups. And so as we continue to develop this, we'll certainly update you. We would love your input on this as well. So that we can be sure again that we are offering equitable learning experiences to every child in Edgecombe County. I'm going to turn over to Dr. Meyer now to share with you a few highlights from across the district.
Thank you, and good evening to everyone. So a couple of the highlights that I'm going to talk about this evening would be our new Edgecademy, STEM learning and post-secondary preparations, and then I'm going to finish up with our summer learning for 22-23. So our Edgecademy of Health Sciences is open to all rising 9th and 10th graders in Edgecombe County Public Schools, as well as our students that will be part of Edgecombe County that are in Demerger. So we will meet with those students in Nash County starting tomorrow evening with a parent meeting. And then next week, we will meet at each of the schools in Nash that have students there, and we will tell them about Edgecademy at that time. So far, we have already started our parent meetings with our students in Edgecombe that have applied, with that. And so DPI allots us $275,000 to open the new early college, and we will need an additional $75,000 to support furniture, technology, and some supplies and materials to be able to get. This is just a quick look at some of the programming that you will see at the early college. Students will have the opportunity to earn a bachelor's degree. I'm sorry, 2 years of transferable credits towards a bachelor's degree. And then, of course, receiving an associate's in arts or an associate's in science degree programs, as well as some certificates that are not listed here that students will have the opportunity to participate and receive when they're in this program. Next, I have a quick video that will give an overview of the Health and Science Academy. Kind of talks about some of the things that are different with this early college versus our other early college. Our students will have the opportunity to participate in athletics, There will be field trips for the students. There will also be an opportunity for them to engage in clubs and activities on their campus as well as with campuses, as well as with Rocky Mount campus of their own college. Moving on to our STEM learning and family nights, I'm just going to put the highlight in the top left-hand corner as our STEM family nights. We've had these at elementary and middle schools throughout the district. First Lego League and First Robotics is the next picture at the top. Our early college students were able to participate in that activity. Students from all over the state were there, and the students had to design and create their own robot and then make that work, that robot work and compete in an arena fashion. The bottom two pictures are from our invention convention where our students got a chance to participate and compete with other schools in the district as well as outside of the district. And we every day try to include STEM in our next, we have our post-secondary preparation. I'm very excited about this because this speaks to not only our students who are going to college, but our students that are ready to go directly into the workforce. The first picture you will see is the College and Career Fair that we held at Southwest and Edgecombe. And beside that picture is our truck fair, where students were able to kind of go out and actually see and experience the different organizations that use those big trucks. And that's always exciting for our students. The bottom left, you will see two students giving CPR to two infant dummies, and this is one of the certifications that our students receive throughout the year, which is CPR and first aid. And then this young lady right here, she's working on computers as part of the tech student program at Edgecombe, and they prepared over 240 laptops this year. And the last bullet there, you can see the different credentials that our students have earned over the year in design, Adobe Photoshop, IT fundamentals, CPR course, stop the bleed, serve safe, and crew managers. So our students are getting the credentials that they need to be able to step right into the workforce. But another part of that is something new that's starting this year, and we are very, very excited about this. We are working in partnership with Carolina Gateways. It's a collaborative effort between Edgecombe County Public Schools and Edgecombe Community College. And this effort is led by Mr. Norris Colson and Dr. Debbie Lamb. And what it will entail, this is going to be targeted towards our 2023 graduates who are planning to go directly into the workforce. And I talked about some of those credentials earlier, but here are two credentials that are vital for industries that are coming to our area, OSHA 10 and Working Smart. And these two credentials will have a total of 40 hours. And our students will receive a stipend, and there will be an opportunity at the end of the program for our students to apply for some of the open positions that we have in our county. So we're very excited that our students will have this opportunity. So couple along with some of the other things that the students are doing in school, this program will definitely be a benefit to our recent graduates and getting them a leg up on the job market. And finally, this is just a highlight of some of our summer programming that we have starting on June 12th, and we will run until August the 11th with our kindergarten transition day.
So we're going to move on to really quick, I'd love to share a few of the exciting things happening at schools across the district. You all may be familiar with some of these things. Some of them are events and other activities you may have taken part in. And I hope that you'll notice as we go through this that all of these experiences align with that vision for learning that I showed you earlier in the presentation. So they're about supporting the whole child. They're about deeper learning, exploring passion and purpose, and then student-led goal setting and reflection. So we'll start on the north side. These are our original innovators here in the district. So at Cooper Wimberly, they're doing some phenomenal work with STEM. They have really leaned into STEM learning, to maker spaces, and the students are actually using tools to solve real-world problems. At Phillips Middle School, they are all about student interest clubs. So students are exploring their passions in a variety of courses, in a variety of clubs. If you'll remember, a couple of years ago, we talked about the North Phillips School of Innovation and the passion projects that students were doing as a part of that. And this is really an outgrowth of that and an iteration on that work. And then at Edgecombe High, they had their first ever learning showcase last fall, where every single student showcased one of their work products to families, to other students, to other educators. It was phenomenal. There's another one coming up on May 12th at 1 o'clock. So Siobhan Creakey, the principal, asked that I invite you May 12th, 1 o'clock indoors. We can send that out afterward. showcasing that something that they have created this school year. In the Southwest Edgecombe feeder pattern, they're doing some great things too. So at GW Carver Elementary, this year they really leaned into project-based learning. So every single teacher has taught a project-based lesson. What you see here is students presenting emergency weather kits they designed to other students at their school. And Dr. Bridges mentioned Rock by Rock. This is actually a Rock by Rock project. So this project was designed by some partners of ours and then implemented by the teachers at Carver Elementary School. And then the students, again, they really took the lead on designing these emergency weather kits. At Bullock, they've got a really cool partnership with Southwest. So this is really highlighting two schools that work together so that Cougar football players come to Bullock Elementary and they partner with teachers and students. They provide mentoring around academics and around social emotional supports. Really, really cool to see the big guys and little guys working together. And then at South Edgecombe Middle, 100% of their students take an academic support class. So they are truly receiving personalized learning in the areas that they need it most. At West Edgecombe, they are part of what we call, or what North Carolina State University calls Project Desire, which is a STEM program. West and Phillips are both a part of this program. They get exposure to all sorts of local businesses. They do really cool things. They build solar-powered remote-controlled cars, right? So these are, Mr. Evans, your employees of the future here, right, at West Edgecombe, and they're ready to go. And then at Southwest, again, they're working on a redesign project with Transcend. They've designed four really cool experiences, advisory pods, purpose pet packs, place-based learning, and social action projects, and they'll be piloting those next year. And then in our Tarboro Princeville area, so our Princeville Elementary Coding Panthers got the chance to show off their skills to the state superintendent of public schools, Catherine Pruitt. At Stocks, they're doing what they call one school, one book. So literally, every single kid in the school has the exact same book. They take it home, they read it with their families, they come back every day, they answer trivia questions, and they get some prizes if they get those trivia questions right. So that's just a really great community building and literacy building initiative at Stocks. They're doing that at Princeville as well. At Patillo, this is the first year they've had a theater arts program. This is the first year of recent history that they've had a theater arts program, and they designed their very own Black History Month performance this year as a part of that theater arts program. And then in MMA, lots of great things. Dr. Bridges mentioned the Spanish Immersion Program, which is still going strong. They also partnered with Teach for America this year in the Ignite Tutoring Program. So they've got over half of their fourth graders receiving virtual math tutoring 3 times a week for 45 minutes. So these are folks that, without cost to us, are zooming in, and they're supporting these students 3 times a week, which is a pretty big deal, and they're seeing a lot of progress with fourth grade now. And then finally, the Edgecombe Early College for Washington, D.C. trip has always been a highlight for the students there, and because of COVID, they haven't been able to take that trip for a number of years. So this year, Mr. Smith and his team took the freshman, sophomore, junior, and senior classes to Washington, D.C. So they spent a lot of time in our nation's capital, but all reports indicate that they've had really, really good experiences there in D.C. And then finally, our Tarboro High and Hope programs are also in a redesign process with Transcend, designing advisory programs, project-based learning, and what they're calling a four-year passion project. So I think that's going to be pretty cool. So they're going to start as freshmen identifying something that they're interested in, and then over the course of the next 4 years, really diving deep into that interest. So they'll do internships, externships, have an opportunity to have mentors in that area, and they're just really, really excited about that opportunity for their students. So with that, Dr. Meyer and I are, I think we're finished. Thank you all so much. Thank you.
Well, we'll take questions as they come.
I heard the first gentleman said that we have $275,000 from DPI. Is that going to pay the salaries for teachers? What exactly was that $275,000?
That would help cover the salary for the principal of the school, the college liaison, and textbooks.
And college group.
Yes.
Okay, so how many have you estimated how many teachers you actually need in that?
We're starting out with 4 to 5 teachers, 4 teachers, and then
in the first go round, or?
Well, Well, I think the first one, I think the next one is a pretty good one.
And I did hear you all say that these students would be able to participate in athletics, whereas the Tarboro campus does not. Why is that?
That's the way that the program is set up.
So we designed it that way. The Tarboro campus was not designed that way. There were liberal arts. We created this one to include sports because we felt like a lot of students choose not to go to Lorenzo College because they want to play sports. We didn't want them to have to make a choice. And so this one was designed when we did our application for DPI. We wrote up the application that way to include sports.
So this population of children will come from?
They'll come. So they'll come from East Coast, but I've also remained the offer to our students that are in Rocky Mountain. That's so that they have an opportunity.
So it is to that sort of initiative.
Okay.
And just with that, your work, that's not true, to make sure that happens.
So they're going in and having meetings, yes.
Because it has to be something on that.
Yes, Ms. Dancy, if there are assistant superintendent, I've been working here over the next couple of weeks to make those decisions happen.
Okay, and you said you're having a meeting tomorrow?
Yes.
Where and when?
At Parker Middle School, and it starts at 6.
At Carmon?
Carmon.
And how are you getting that information out to the people in the area or the residents?
I guess the question is, just a spare plan, or is it a public?
Yeah, it's a public meeting, and it's for the families of the students that live in Edgecombe County that attend that county school, and they have been advertising on their social media to get it out and send information out to their community they call in that county. That's one of the things that the stance is going to have.
Dr. Lorenzo, I forgot to ask you, we talked about the schools. Do we have in that presentation alphabets, or that's not part of that, of what schools, A, what A, A, B, S, F?
So say your question again.
In that part where you said about the number of schools, how you increased?
Did I have the letter grades? I did not include the letter grades. I can go back and do that, but I did not.
Thank you.
Mr. Sharp, someone here.
So far,
Just want to highlight just a couple of these, if you don't mind. We reviewed and revised the innovative research-based school models from all of our inspiration visits. And we studied those. We want to try and adopt some of those and bring those to our system. We're also looking at some additional models in Lake County, at elementary school, at the middle school, and we also visited Inlow High School in the magnet system. And we have some great ideas. We think about implementing some of those, but we're not able to do so yet until we get into the school. We also are seeking to promote that innovation at the local level here from all of those relationships that we built with those schools and those places. We also visited the Montessori School, Lakewood, in Durham, North Carolina. We brought back some great ideas there. We conducted end-to-end interviews with the design team members and some of the members here. So I commit right now to you all that each and every one of you are on my end-to-end interview list. So get ready. I've already shared with some of you that I'll be looking forward to meeting with you, and I'm excited about that. Well, here you'll notice that there's lots of information, and this is the information that sort of provides a little bit of a litmus regarding what we've done so far, right? There are probably four slides, and it would take forever, and I would roll my 10-minute limit, Dr. Bridges, if I did that. So I promise her that we would just review them just briefly, provide an opportunity for you all to look at those, peruse those, and if you have questions or concerns, just email me, text me, or call. This is our March review. This consists of everything we did for the month of March. This is our April review. And this is what I want to sort of highlight a little bit for you, right? This is the Demerger implementation timeline. Now, this timeline is not all encompassing, obviously, but it does highlight some of the critical areas that we are trying to make sure that we highlight here and that we bring forward for your approval. In January, you can see what we were able to do. The onboarding process in this county was a lot different from what I dreamed it would be. I was so pleasantly surprised and excited to come back home to see that our system had changed so much. I was a student here. I'm a proud individual. Born and raised here in Tarboro, North Carolina, now three schools on street, and also a product of the projects, and proud of that. And the reason why I mentioned that, you're probably wondering why to mention it. Well, the reason why I'm mentioning that is because I looked at the socioeconomic status of the students who live on the eastern side of the railroad track. And those students are me. They are who I am. And so, if you look at January, we participated in the onboard activities, and the system was so great and so kind, and all the administrators, district, the political leaders, the business leaders were so nice about embracing me and making sure to bring me up to snuff in terms of what I need to learn about the county so that I could utilize that information and moving forward and providing for our students what their needs and assessments were. Okay. If you look quickly at February, you can see we did there in March, April, and currently we're moving towards May. One of the things I'd like to share with you right now is I need your help. I don't know any other way to say it. I need your assistance and I need your support. Whoever has the relationships with those members of the board in Nash, or you have friends who are in Nash, or whatever the case may be, or who are in Rocky Mountain, greater Rocky Mountain area, if you are able to somehow convince them to allow us to move into the schools, right, so that we can assess the student capability there, so that we can assess the teacher report card, so that we can assess the conditions of the buildings, so that we can assess all of their programs, so that we can start planning for the influx of youngsters who we will soon inherit in Edgecombe County, I would be very appreciative of that. Here are our progress updates. Just we're going to highlight a couple of them real briefly. We communicated the district status and emergencies with our key stakeholders, but that does not include our community. Our community is the piece that's missing. That's the missing piece. And we find it very difficult and very challenging to be able to share the information regarding which school their students will be, or should I say, how students will be attending, what the physical makeup, what those models, those two models will look like, because it's difficult to really get into those schools. So we need that assistance and support to get in there. It's really a critical need. We actually tried accessing those buildings. We tried accessing those campuses through several different communication means, and we've not met with much success. So I look forward, Mr. Evans, to our next county line diversion meeting so we can have a conversation about that, and perhaps we can make some changes. Additionally, here are some additional progress updates. And you can see that we solidified the merger team design meeting dates and decision-making time. That was a huge one because it was kind of difficult to do that because of the ambiguity regarding where we were in terms of looking at the campuses, because it's in order to make an authentic, create an authentic plan, we obviously have to be able to get into those buildings. I'm going to switch gears for a quick second and talk about the current focus area and our financial support. If you all know of any entities that are willing to invest in us and in our schools, we would appreciate that feedback also. You have my contact information. I'm really, really aggressive about going after that support, going after those financial opportunities, right? And the reason why I say that is because I talked to our mayor. Not our mayor, but Rocky Mountain Mayor Sandy Robinson. And Rocky Mountain Mayor Sandy Robinson shared with me that North Coast would be a great contact. Well, we tried working through that. We weren't as successful as we would prefer. However, we're not going to give up. We also, are perusing the Twin County News leaders and local political leaders through the General Assembly. And we received some promises, but nothing really in writing. We heard conversation about $3-4 million, perhaps, us being able to access that money, but nothing truly concrete has occurred. Nothing in writing, nothing that says that we have that money. So we're going to keep plugging. We're not going to give up because our youngsters deserve that. Additionally, very excited about our opportunity with the New School Venture Fund. We participated in the second round of the interviews. I think we did a really good job and a move because they sort of came back and asked us for some additional information. And Ms. Swanson was able to provide that information to them. So we're eagerly anticipating a response from them probably within the next 21 days, depending on how long. We're excited about also solidifying our school model. That's another area where we're sort of handcuffed right now. It's so difficult to create those wonderful school models that people serve in Edgecombe County, and that we've reviewed through Ms. Swanson, through Dr. Merritt, through our superintendent. We've got some exciting things going on here in our county. And we'd like to be able to share some of those accomplishments, some of those celebratory type activities, right? And it's difficult for us to do that without getting into our schools and be able to share through those community meetings, through those teacher fairs, etc. Now, just real quickly, the roll of the design team, how much time do I have left?
2 minutes.
Okay. Real quickly,
4 minutes. Sorry, 4 minutes.
4 minutes?
Yes.
Okay. Real quickly, the role of our design team. Our design team is committed group of hardworking individuals who I have the pleasure of working with. And I thank you all so much for those recent hires. For Ms. Arlene Gordon Gray, for Ms. Jessica Parker, for Ms. England Austin, for others who have contributed, as well as the district leadership who was sort of doping in and helped to support us. We appreciate that, and I just want you all to know that. As well as the county commissioners, our board members, and our superintendent staff. Additionally, this design team plays a critical role. There's a couple of design teams. There's that club design team. There's a small crew of young people who are really excited and really committed to making sure youngsters have what they need to be successful. And I know you all can feel the passion in my voice for this, because again, I'm proud of, I have that experience. I've seen my siblings, I've seen my nieces, my nephews, I've seen my community members who I grew up with experience so much success coming from this small town that we always brag about. Tarboro, North Carolina, and Edgecombe County. And so I know that we can make it happen. And you said, Mr. Edgecombe, I know that we can make this happen. But we need everybody working together and supporting us. We're going to disagree about a lot of different things, but I think we can all agree on one thing, that we want what's best for our children. We want to make sure that they have the best chance to be successful. These are our new members. I mentioned just a few of them, but I don't want to leave out the remaining members. Dr. McLeod, please. Right away, it's going to be Ashton, Ms. McGee, Ms. Dove, Ms. Batts, Ms. Nettles, and Ms. Boston. We thank Jessica Parker and Pauline Gordon Brand also for their concerted efforts to make sure we're successful. And these are our spring design meetings. They were recently okay. And we'll start on Monday, May 1st. That meeting will be held at Edgecombe Community College. We're going to get that information out to everyone. And Eric, can I borrow some from you real quick? Okay. Will you all work this part together? Because we're going to need you all. We're going to need you all. So we're going to start at the top together.
Together, as a design team, will build a new approach that will move students, scholars, and Edgecombe County public schools graduates and possible future.
Together, the design team will build, combined with the hopes and dreams of our young people and their families in the Edgecombe County public school system. Okay. And these are our next steps. Any questions?
Conversation about it being K through 9th grade. So we have
lot of questions that can probably answer this now. Because the final official action to be taken is what we done at our budget. That is, we've got to be careful of that. Make sure that these things are great, that they don't know what they're going to do those schools. And they can't answer, they cannot answer what they're going to do with those schools, okay? And, but what we do know is that if we take that action, they got to do something, okay? Something will be done, okay? Trust me, that's what I said. I don't think you're in a position to answer all this, okay? That's why I put it on the, okay?
Well, see, that's my concern with parents. And parents that have come to me, I haven't been able to answer anything to our firm, to the school board. With the parents, when y'all have these meetings, because if I was a parent, I would ask you, is my child going to be bused to another school, or are they going to remain in this school? And Edgecombe County is just going to maintain to take over these schools and maintain them as they should be? Or is my child going to get on a bus and go to a school in Edgecombe County public school? Now, that's as a parent, that's what I would be asking. So are we prepared to tell parents anything when they ask that question? Because I know parents are right now, their relatives of mine are going to ask that question.
Okay, so when they ask that question, our purpose for our meetings is to ask a conversation around what are their preferences, what are their needs. What we found is that no one has asked the parents. People have told them what they're asking for. No one has asked them. So the purpose of our meetings is to ask them, what is it you like, what are the things you want to do? And that allows us opportunity to do something, not to just do things to them. They don't have that. And so it is important that we get into school. So I'm sure we'll have a meeting early today that gives us an opportunity to get into the schools to have those meetings, to be able to meet the parents before the school year ends, so that then during the summer, we have lots of work that needs to happen. And so, of course, our team, our summer's going to look different than it has in the past. Like, the same work you'll be doing, that's not what you'll be. You'll have to do some other things. We'll have people, multiple teams working to work on some of that work, because it will have to happen quickly, right? We'll have about a year term, but we can make it happen.
And I also think that, annually, I think all school districts should, it changes where you go to school. The school districts change. So I'm saying this is going to change the last time school system in terms of the assignment process, I think, is an active process. So, but I do think that all of these questions do get answered. And we are planning. Hope to find some of our conversations that we want to lead in each of those schools. We want to have leads with parents in each of those schools. That's what changes, okay? So that we can make that and hope that we will make sure that the parents can go all of those involved, all of us that are involved can attend those schools. We intend to have those parents' questions. We will have a lot of questions, and a lot of them ask the questions, but a lot of them cannot be. You don't have to have such a chance to be able to tell them what we're planning to
do. And we do assure the board, the members of the county commissioners, that we will have these answers and that the work will be done. We will get it done. There's no question. We will ask the parent, we will ask you. We're working at it. Any other questions?
Stay tuned, be back, taking a 10-minute break.